All right, we're going to get started. My name is Bryce Covert, and my title, the title of my talk is called Use Lisp with Game. And we're going to be talking about making a point-and-click adventure game in Clojure. So when I was young, I used to play a lot of games like these. King's Quest, Monkey Island, Full Throttle, Simon the Sorcerer. How many people in here have played an adventure game like this? Great. So I still play games like these pretty regularly. And for those that don't know, though, adventure games started out as games where you would move around with the keyboard, type commands into an interpreter, and have the game respond. And they were largely narrative and puzzle-driven. As you, in the first iterations in building a parser, that evolved as we invented the mouse, and you'd be able to move around clicking to talk to people, interact with objects, and that kind of thing. They try to implement this on the NES, and let's just say they only made one attempt. So when I first saw King's Quest when I was 7 years old, I decided I want to be a game programmer, and that's pretty much why I'm here today. I started out by making QBasic games, little text adventure games, and RPGs, and that kind of thing. I even tried making a remake of King's Quest IV when I was in high school, and that didn't really turn into anything. Most of these are pretty embarrassing to look at, but sometimes you just gotta hashtag own it. So 15 years later, since then, I got a job as a web developer, learned .NET, C#, Ruby, Python, kind of make the path more and more towards functional programming. And about 2.5 years ago, I started writing Clojure, and I decided enough was enough. It's time to make an adventure game and finish it. So that's where Tick's Tales was born. A little bit about it. It's written 100% in Clojure. I use PlaySealJ, which my old coworker Zach Oakes made. It's really great. It's going to be released for Windows, OS X, and Linux. Should be next month, maybe the month afterwards, depending on how things go with the publisher. And it started out as a way to get better at Clojure. I wouldn't actually advise making an adventure game as a way to get better at Clojure, because you'll spend a lot of time writing content and not really a lot of time writing code. And it's about 12,000 lines of code. So I want to show you a little bit about what I learned along the way. We're going to talk about making SCUMM-style dialogue trees with Clojure Zip, and creating in-game cutscenes, which is kind of the basis of everything you do in an adventure game, with core async. And also talking about getting rid of using editors and tools for making games, and really just building the entire game on the fly using a REPL. And we'll talk about a couple things, small things that I learned along the way as well. What this game's really not going to be very much about is making a game engine. Alex had a really good talk about that before. And in fact, most of the examples that we're going to be looking at are just going to be Clojure script reagent apps. I wanted to boil these problems into the simplest, most digestible form. And honestly, a game isn't really the easiest way to do that. So let's talk about SCUMM. SCUMM stands for Script Creation Utility for Maniac Mansion. It's kind of like the JVM, if you will, of pretty much all the LucasArts adventure games that you're familiar with. And a common feature in these games is that you'd be able to choose what you'd say, which is pretty different from how the Sierra games worked. So what would happen is you'd see a list of choices, you would make a choice, and some dialogue would happen, and you would then be presented with more choices. And those choices might be a subset of the original choices, or it might be a next set of choices that were related to the one that you just chose. So we're going to take some famous dialogue, hopefully most of you guys know this dialogue, and we're going to adapt this into an adventure game dialogue tree. I thought about trolling everybody by using this dialogue, but I figured everybody would get up and leave, or at least send me an email saying something like, from my point of view, the prequels are evil. So what we're going to do is we're going to try as best as we can to be faithful to the spirit of the original script and adapt it into a dialogue tree. So when Luke is presented with his first two choices of things that he could say, he's going to be able to say, how did my father die? And you fought in the Clone Wars. And when we say, how did my father die? Obi-Wan's going to talk about a young Jedi named Darth Vader. And then we're presented with a new list of choices. And when we choose one of those, we have some new choices that appear as a result of the one that we chose. But this last choice, something else here, is a little bit different. It's going to actually move back up the tree. so that we can go back and ask him or tell him that we wish he'd known his father. And if we choose something else again, we can go back up to the root node there. So how might we implement something like this? There's one way. If you ever picked up one of these books from the late 80s, early 90s on how to make computer games in QBasic, you would do stuff like this, where you would type some messages and present them with a choice and let you type in the answer. You'd end up, these books were kind of like GitHub, except you had to pay for it, and instead of git clone, you just kind of typed the whole program out. So our instincts probably tell us this is like not the right way to do it. And why is that? First, that it really isn't a dialogue tree. It just happens to be a dialogue tree. Just by doing the right go-to statements here, we result in a dialogue tree. So you could almost call it like an accidental dialogue tree. And this primitive case doesn't really keep track of where we are at all, right? If two pieces of dialogue, two choices actually end up going to the same place, and you present the same next choices, you'd have to have some way of keeping track of where you were. And it gets really, really complex as soon as you try to do anything dynamic. Say, if Luke has his lightsaber, he's going to have some different choices that he can say. And that dynamic nature isn't really going to come out in this. So what if instead we can model it actually as a tree in a data structure? So that might look something like this, where we have a collection of choices. That's what I'm going to call these things that have headings. A run script, that's what happens when you choose that choice, and then a collection of choices that happen afterwards. We can traverse this tree using get in enclosure, right? We could just say, give me the first thing, the choices for that thing, and then give me the second choice and get the heading off of it, and we would see, but my father was a navigator. But there's a tool that Clojure provides that makes this a lot simpler for us, and that's called Clojure Zip. How many people have used a zipper so far? Okay, great. So for those that don't know, zipper works like this. You provide three functions that sort of describe what your tree-like data structure is and then the root of your data structure. So branch says, can this node have children? Children says, give me a function that returns the sequence of children for the node, and make node will take a node and set up children on that node. So in our example, the branch and children are actually the same thing. A node can have children if it has a choices key on it. The children will be the choices. If you call choices on that node, you'll get the children. And to create a new node, we just associate the sequence of children onto the node. Now, this last little line here for the root might seem a little bit weird, but as we saw how we define that conversation tree, it's a collection of choices, and we really need one root of the for the node. So we're just going to have a kind of a secret map here that contains the root with the first set of choices. So after we create a zipper like this, what can we do? We can start with our zipper, and if we call down on it, we move to the first choice, how did my father die? And if we call down on it again, we get to, I wish I'd known him. And if we call right, we can get to, but my father was a navigator. And this is where the behavior from get in works a little bit differently. We're actually keeping track, as you can see, this kind of works recursively on the zipper, and we can move back up the tree by calling up. So this is going to allow us to navigate around. Now, if at any point we wanted to say get the children from this node, we're going to do something like this. We're going to call children, and we're going to map heading, and that's going to let us, say, get the list of things. After you chose how did my father die, that gives us the list of things that we need to present as the next choice. So we've seen how choices is the means by which we communicate what the next level of the tree is, but how do we actually navigate around this thing? We've seen there's something else that needs to move us up the tree, but how does that actually work? What we're going to do is we're going to add one more key to our choice here, and that's called next. And how that's going to work is next is going to take a zipper and return a zipper that is at the node for whose choices you want to present. So in the case of something else, you might look at this and say, well, I thought we would be moving one level up. And instead, it's up. The reason why is what we're really doing is we're doing this. This picture doesn't look as pretty, which is why I didn't start out with that one. But basically what's happening here is we have a zipper on the something else node. We move up to go to, but my father was a navigator, and then up one more level to get to the root node. So in the end, our data structure is going to look like this, where we have a collection of choices, which can have a collection of choices, which can have a collection of choices, or these next functions that move us around. If we don't provide a next function, by default it's going to be identity, meaning I'm going to provide the next level of dialogue. So our zipper is only going to change a little bit with this implementation. We're just going to say you either have a choices key or you have a next key to be able to have children. So let's take a look at an example of that. Here we have our dialogue tree, and I can say, how did my father die? And Obi-Wan's going to respond about Darth Vader. And I can say, but my father was a navigator. And then we can move back up the tree by calling something else. Now, one thing that's going to happen here is the but my father was a navigator is now grayed out. And that's because we already chose that option. If we go back up one more level, we'll see that's grayed out as well. And we're going to take a look at how we actually do that. So here is our tree in its entirety. Let me get this a little bit more in view. Can everybody see that? Okay, great. So if we look at the implementation of these next functions, we have back, which just basically presents the same choices we just saw. Gives us the option to repeat the same selection. But something else is going to do something else. What we can see is it calls this up, and then it calls scene on it. And what that's going to do is it's going to edit the node. This is provided by Clojure Zip. And it's going to just set this scene flag on it. And this is a little hint in terms of how we're going to do much more dynamic behavior with these dialogue trees. So I want to show you a little puzzle from Tick's Tales where we need to convince this antique shopkeeper that we know who her long-lost son was in order to get that teddy bear from the shelf. And we actually don't know her long-lost son's name, and so we're going to be presented with some random choices of random names, and as we make a choice, he's going to say that, and then she's going to respond, of course, that's not her son's name, and then be presented with another option that's just another random name. And you can do this, you know, someone might try playing this game and think that they just need to keep doing it until they find the right name, but that's not how it works. So we're going to adapt this name guessing puzzle to another Star Wars puzzle where we're going to guess Luke's sister's name. And so he might not know, he might not have enough of the force to be able to tell that it's Leia. But each time we choose one of these people, the characters from Star Wars names, we're just going to edit our current node and change the choice to a new random name. So let's take another look at how we're going to implement that. So here is the entirety of that. Let's see if I can get this centered a little bit better. Okay, so what we're going to do is this, the first choice Yoda spoke of another doesn't actually have any choices on it. It's going to be entirely dynamic. And our next function is going to take our zipper, and what it's going to do is it's going to take from the names, it's going to shuffle them up, and it's going to take three random ones. Then what it's going to do is it's going to map each one of those names into a choice, following the exact same syntax we saw before. But each one of the next functions for that, all they're going to do is when you choose that choice, it's going to replace its heading with a different one of those names and move back up. And we also are going to have the choice, if you do know the Leia, we will move. It'll basically work just like something else in this example. And we have our something else choice. And all we do is we edit the zipper, set the choices to the concatenation of these of the three dynamic choices, the Leia choice, and the something else choice. So this gives us a lot of flexibility in terms of building these dialogue trees. So next we're going to talk about building some of the in-game scripts in Clojure. Here's another little scene from Tick's Tales, which we're going to actually simulate, where Tick goes and knocks on Gandalf's door, or he actually just barges in, and interrupts Gandalf, and Gandalf isn't exactly that excited to see him. So we're going to implement this basic script in Clojure, and it's going to look something like this. Our player walks to some position, he waits, there for 500 milliseconds, and then he says, is anybody home? In this example, instead of animating an open door, I'm just going to remove the door. And he's going to walk in and greet Gandalf. And then we're going to have some dynamic behavior that decides how he responds. So there's a couple goals in what we're trying to do in writing scripts this way. We actually want to write these in an imperative way, which might seem as a little bit of a shocker. But the idea is that as we learn more about functional programming, we try to stop talking about how things should work or what they should do and start talking about what things are. In the case of this example in a game, a frame is a function of the previous frame and state. And we kind of like to think about things that way. But when we're talking about scripts, we are really talking about a sequence of actions that we want to happen, right? We want him to walk to this position. We want to have him wait, and those kinds of things. Additionally, we want to be able to talk about the current game state when we're making decisions about what to do. So we don't want to just pass the state into our script and then have it use it, because we're dealing with immutable data structures, it's not going to change, and to not be able to make any decisions about where we are in the game at that point. So we want to be able to talk about the state of the game at that time. And the last thing is we don't really want to think about these actions asynchronously unless it's important to the script. What do I mean by that? What I mean is that when we say walk to some position, it's going to take some number of frames. This wouldn't really be that exciting if any time we ran a script, it just happened immediately, and we reached the Gandalf before he had even had an opportunity to react. What we want to happen is we walk to some position, some number of frames happen, and then once that's finished, we pick it up and say, is anybody home? So one of the questions in the last talk, someone asked something about coroutines as a way to kind of solve some of these problems. And this is a very common approach to handling scripting. And basically what a coroutine or a generator in C# and Python let you do is kind of have something like function state, and that a function kind of becomes pausable and resumable and you can pick it up. Another way to do this is to implement callbacks, right? So the idea would be you go do this stuff, and once you're done, you call this function as what to do next. And then another approach is to do multi-threading, where you stop trying to make this all happen on one thread. You have one thing that's monitoring what's going on and say, Tick needs to walk to this position and update where he is each frame. And using core async, it's kind of a little bit of a mixture of all of these. It really most resembles coroutines and multi-threading in this example. So we're going to take a quick look at this same script just pared down to that bare minimum. So if I hit start script, this is not quite as exciting because there's no animations, no music, no camera, but we see the same basic idea, and we're going to look at how we could do something like this. So Alex talked a little bit about how you could do main game loops, and this is not one of those ways. But in our simple reagent app, this is just going to suffice, where basically we sleep for 10 milliseconds, we take the state, we call render on it, which is going to return an updated game state, and we also keep track of the fact that we move 10 milliseconds in the future. Those don't actually stay very in sync because render takes some amount of time. So what does this state look like? You also shouldn't do this either, but for a simple example, this will also suffice. So we're going to have a collection of entities, which are going to be mapped as key value pairs. So we would say player has this position, and here's an image that represents him, and a color for his dialogue. And we're also going to have a script that we keep track of. And that's going to keep track of what script's currently running, what action is currently running, and we'll see how that works. So really quickly, I want to revisit what this simple script looks like. We have these series of steps, say walk to, wait, and say, that happen one after another. And what we're going to do is when we call walk to, we're going to reify a protocol called iAction, and it's going to put it onto this channel that both sides know about called ActionChan. And the main loop, every single frame, if it's not doing anything, is going to read from that ActionChan and say, is there anything that I should be doing? If it picks one up, it's going to do that until completion and then put the current game state back onto another chan called AwakeChan. And that will wake up the game script, allowing it to continue to the next thing. So what does this iAction protocol look like? Basically, it's composed of three functions, begin, update, and finished. Begin says, given the state of the world, return a new state of the world with this action having begun. Update action says, given a state of the world, put me one frame closer to this action having been completed. And finish action says, given the state of the world, is this action complete? So what might an action like this look like? Here's an example. We have walk to. It takes in a who, which is just a key, if it's going to be our wizard, or if it's the player, tick in this case, a destination that's going to be an x, y coordinate, and some optional parameters. And what we're going to do is we're going to reify that iAction protocol. We're going to say begin. The way to update the world state is to start this animation walk on whoever is moving. An update action is going to move us one step closer at the speed at which we're supposed to move to the destination. And we know that we're finished when the distance to the destination is less than the speed. So let's take a look a little bit deeper at how that works. So I promised you that we would be able to write this in a really nice way, and for now I lied. And what we see is we see some of these actions just like we saw before, like walk to, and we're going to put it on the action chain, and we're going to read from the action chain. And in our main game loop, we are going to render based on the current state, so this is going to return an updated state. Let's actually take a look at the implementation for this. So what we're going to do is we keep track on, see, does that show pretty good? Let's do this. We keep track of the current script that's running, and we're sharing between these two threads, the action chain and the awake chain, and we keep track of the current action that's running. So if a script isn't running, we don't do anything. If we didn't click on that link to go and barge in on Gandalf, it's just going to do nothing. If we don't have a current action, what we're going to do is we're going to use core async to pull from the action chain, and it's going to that's going to be its current action until that is completed. So we call begin action on it, and then we keep track of this current action for the subsequent steps. If we do have an action, we check to see if it's finished. So if it is finished, we go and put the current state onto that awake chain, and so that the script can keep track of what's going on. And we call update action one more time to allow the script to complete. So if we said that if you're walking, we know we're done when the distance is less than the speed. Well, we'll take that final step and reach our destination. And finally, if we have an action and it's not complete yet, we're going to call update action on it, moving us one step closer. So there's a few things that I didn't show in this implementation. One is we didn't do simultaneous scripts. It's pretty easy to imagine how we would implement this, though. We have a scripts key, and that only had one script on it, but we can imagine very easily turning that into a collection of scripts. So if we want to have, say, a character walking around in the background and having Tick still be able to move around and talk to someone else, we could do that by having multiple scripts running at the same time. Another thing that I didn't show is doing simultaneous actions. So the idea would be, say, Tick is running out the door of Gandalf's house while Gandalf is yelling out, like, "Never come back," something like that. How we would do that is actually one of core async's really strong suits, right? So what we saw before is we're putting something onto the action chain and then waiting for the awake chain to wake it back up. But what's happening there is our script is actually the one that's being in charge of knowing when to continue. So what we could do is we could easily say, put two actions onto the action chain and wake up when the first one of them is completed using alts, or wait for both of them to be completed. And that becomes really, really powerful. One thing that I haven't really created a good implementation for is how we would do a composition of actions. So perhaps walking and talking is an example of that, is that I want Tick to be walking while he's talking, going to some destination. And when I try to explain to people why Java is bad, I'll say that like a class is a terrible container for behavior. We already have something for that, a function. I'm not sure, maybe the same applies to actions in this example, that maybe an action isn't the best container for behavior. And so I've kind of started thinking about what it might be like to have these work more like trampoline, where if the result of the function is another function, then we know to call that again. But I haven't really created a great implementation for that, so if you have any ideas, feel free to let me know. There's one more thing I want to show that I forgot to show before. actually two things I'm going to show. So how can we make that script better, right? I promised that we would be able to read it pretty easily, and this is this pretty convoluted repeated sequence of steps here. It's pretty easy using Clojure to just define a macro that does that. So I just basically created a macro that automates that behavior, and it sort of assumes that each one of these forms is going to return an action that it's going to put on the action chain, and then it'll wait for to be woken back up. The implementation for this is pretty gnarly in Clojure script because the namespace for putting something onto a channel and reading from a channel is different. It's Clojure script, core async in Clojure script, but you have to write the macro in Clojure. So this doesn't exactly read so well. I did want to show really quickly as well the implementation of that name guessing example from Luke talking to Obi-Wan. So if we say you spoke of another, we can see this dynamic nature that we saw the code for. And if we leave and we come back, so it says it must have slipped my mind, and we learn the secret of that it's Leia, we can say Yoda spoke of another. And now our Leia choice is visible here. So both of these examples are going to be up on my GitHub account directly following this presentation. So I want to show one more thing. I want to show one more thing that I learned in making Tick's Tales, and that's how to make a game completely using the REPL. And hopefully we'll fare a little bit better than Roger Wilco using this parser here. So I'm going to actually show you for the first time here really Tick's Tales running. So I'm going to kick off the game, and it's going to actually start up an nREPL port. And it's starting nREPL server listening on this port. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to load up a save here. And I'm going to try to minimize the spoilers here, but what I can do is I can click on the sheep and I can take some of its wool. And maybe as a game designer, I'm looking at this and I'm going, that's not a very good reaction from Tick. He's just not that excited about that wool. That's really exciting. So what we're going to do is connect to that running nREPL server. And I'm just going to add one line of code here. This is a little bit different from what we looked in the Clojure script example because this is the real game. And I'm going to compile that. And now here we are back. We rewound time actually, and we're back before I even picked that wool. And so when I click on the sheep one more time, he's going to have a better reaction. So this is really huge. The ability to just build this game while it's running, very similar to what Alex showed in his example, is really big. If you decide you want to do this with PlayCLJ, it doesn't really come out of the box. I created an nREPL middleware that lets you do this. It's also on my GitHub. Oops. I guess I should quit the game. It's up on my GitHub here. So I want to talk really briefly about a couple lessons I learned along the way. The first is that Clojure really made it easy to make changes to the game. It was almost comical how many times I had some constant value and I just wanted to replace it with a function so that it would be dynamic. A perfect example in that script that we actually saw in the game, there's a cauldron that's bubbling, and originally I just had a bubbling sound. But what I wanted to do is I wanted to get louder as Tick got closer to it, or if he walked off the screen to the left, it would pan to the right as he was walking. It was really easy to say, oh, well, I'm just going to take these constant pan and volume levels and I'm going to replace them with a function, make it be based off the current game state, and you can do whatever you want. I probably abused that just about to the point in which it doesn't work anymore. Like, I probably should do something more like what Alex did with an entity component system, but it worked. And another thing that I learned is that this started out as something I hoped to finish in 3 months, and it didn't really take that long because it was hard to make a game. It's actually really easy to write 12,000 lines of Clojure. What's really hard is making those 12,000 lines funny. So another thing that I would really encourage anyone who's interested in this. PlayCLJ makes it really, really easy to get started. You can, in 5 minutes, start making a game and seeing behavior. But I would just encourage you not to think that that's just going to mean that it's going to scale linearly from there and it's going to be easy to make and complete a game. On the topic of performance tuning, very similar to what Alex was talking about, garbage collection is kind of part of the problem here in that every frame is a function of the previous frame, and we're using immutable data structures to update state as time goes on, and that by its very nature means that some amount of memory allocation is happening. And I was able to, it didn't cause too many problems, but any time that the garbage collector does fire, it does slow down a little bit, but because everything else is kind of going 60 frames per second, you barely notice it. But I did have to go through in a couple places and find places where I was unnecessarily having data structures along the way and try to minimize the creation of those intermediate data structures. And one other thing that I kind of want to talk about is code is data. This sort of this like promise in Lisp that your code is the same thing as your data, and like that's cool, but how does it actually apply to real life? It actually was really cool here because what I wanted to do as the game was sort of winding down, I'd implemented everything, but I had a tester who was going to go through all the code and check for, or all the dialogue and check for spelling mistakes, grammar mistakes, and that kind of thing. I just said, well, I have this say action or this do dialogue action, and I searched the entire code base, kind of do a tree walk on the entire code base, pull out all the strings that are inside of those functions, and now I have the entire collection of lines. And I just dumped that to a CSV, sent it to him, and he found a lot of problems because I can maybe write good closure, but I can't write good dialogue. So I want to thank everybody here. I'm going to have both those examples up on my GitHub. And any questions? Sure.
You mentioned that you can have multiple scripts running at the same time if you have a collection of them. Have you ever found the need in your game to have one script be able to cancel another script? And did you find a way you liked?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So I did. An example is, I'm tempted to just show it, but I'm not going to. So there's a character who's sort of working at a desk, and he's reading out loud some of the stuff that he's writing down. And a perfect example of that is where I have a script that I needed to have. If I click on him, I'm going to go and interrupt him, and that's a script in itself too. There were a lot of bugs in trying to resolve that problem. That was the only place where I really sort of ran into it. I think what I did is anytime you, in that case, I explicitly wrote some code that killed that process. It wasn't a very good solution, and if it was any larger scale game, I think we need to come up with a better solution for that for sure. Yeah?
When you were composing the scripts, did you write it directly into the data structures in the source file, or did you like write in a text file somewhere else later?
Yeah, good question. So a good part of the 12,000 lines of code is the dialogue. So I did write it in Clojure. I showed all those things that I did when I was younger in high school and stuff, and I never finished any of those projects. And I think part of the reason why is because I spent so much time making an editor and kind of solving the fun problems but not solving the problems of content. And so for this, I just wanted to use Lisp because Clojure's great, and so I wanted to not have to do that. I may need to do that in the future, if I decide to port this to other languages. I haven't even really looked into localizing it, but there's a good chance I would need to pull all that stuff out and come up with a different approach. Yep?
My vague understanding about the game developer system, so I don't know for sure, but I understand a lot of games use automata to represent various parts of the game state.
Yep. Yeah. The question was about using Automa to incorporate something about manipulating the game state. I have thought about it starting yesterday at the conversation about hybrid Automa. I thought about adding in the common approaches to the scripting thing. I thought about adding that, but in all honesty, I'm still sort of grappling with it, so I can't answer it directly, but I'm definitely going to explore that as a better way to model this stuff in the future. Yep?
Do
I really didn't have to do very much. I think I used it's the profiler that comes with the Oracle JDK, JVisual VM or something like that, to monitor garbage collection. There was really only two performance things that I needed to do. One was eliminating a couple of those intermediate data structures, and the second was my pathfinding. In all honesty, the approach that I took to pathfinding, I would probably do some things different, because what I did is I just used a black and white image of every single screen in the game to represent where you can pass and where you can't, and that results in a very, very large graph. So the problem there was really sort of self-inflicted. If I had created an editor, I might have done some kind of nav mesh implementation, which would have been a lot faster. But I really didn't have to do very much of that. I did, I've done some tests in doing this on mobile, on iOS and Android, and I found that I wrote a couple of custom shaders, and the coding thing that you get from Apple? Xcode has some great, I was really surprised at its ability to do some diagnostics on my like shader code, which until I made this game I'd never done before. It had some, showed some of the problems that would happen in iOS, so I used that as well. Great. Oh, one more.
You mentioned doing like composable behaviors. Have you thought about trying to leverage transducers
I've thought about it a little bit, but I think part of the problem is in the nature that each of those actions I was showing, they take a step. Each one of them takes time to complete, and we call a function on every frame for them. So I'm not entirely sure how I could use transducers, but if you have like ideas, we can chat more afterwards. Yeah. Yeah, that's a great question. So the question was, would I, now that I finished this one, would I create an engine or would I continue with what I was doing here? I think I would create an engine. Or at least, I might still use libgdx, although libgdx I found has a lot of flaws. And I found that out the hard way. It would be really hard to know going in that it has those problems. But I think the thing that I would do differently is play CLJ. I cannot stress enough how awesome it is for getting started, but I actually, in creating this, I had to create a fork of it and make my own changes to a number of things to be able to just do more advanced stuff. So I think what I would do differently is I would implement an entity component system, kind of like what we saw in the previous talk, and I would probably take the best bits of Play CLJ and kind of give the full power back to me in making the game. Great. Well, thanks, everybody.